Good evening. This is TV7 Israel News, broadcasting to you from Jerusalem. And in today's top stories, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu warned of Iran's systematic efforts to lie to the world about its true regional intentions and vowed that Israel will continue to act as necessary to thwart Tehran's aggressive expansionist aspirations. The Iranian Navy announced that it successfully test-fired a cruise missile during its annual naval exercise dubbed Vilayat 97. A first historic summit between the European Union and the League of Arab States concluded this evening, with economic cooperation and conflict resolution topping the conference's agenda. Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu warned of Iran's systematic efforts to lie to the world about its true regional intentions. In remarks at his weekly cabinet meeting, the Prime Minister stressed that despite Iran's efforts to deceive the world, the Islamic Republic, which seeks to destroy the Jewish state, must understand that Israel is not deceived and that it will continue to act as necessary in order to block Iran's military entrenchment in Syria.
שמענו אתמול בכיר במשטר הטרור האיראני אומר איראן השיגה יותר מ-90% מהיעדים שלה בסוריה. טוב, זה לא נכון. אבל זה נכון שהם מנסים, וזה נכון שאנחנו בולמים אותה. לפני כחודש אמר גורם איראני אחר שהם רק מייעצים לסוריה. כלומר, העולם שומע הרבה מאוד שקרים מאיראן. יש לי מסר ברור למשטר האיראני שרוצה בהשמדת ישראל. ישראל תמשיך לפעול ככל שידרש כדי לבלום את ההתבססות הצבאית האיראנית בסוריה.
Netanyahu referred to the Secretary of the Islamic Republic's Supreme National Security Council, Ali Shamhani, who claimed that Iran fulfilled 90% of its goals in Syria. In that same statement, Secretary Shamhani also claimed that Israel's airstrikes on Iranian installations in the war-torn country had no strategic effect. Meanwhile, to assure the Israeli military's freedom of operation in its northern neighbors, Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu announced that he will travel to Moscow on Wednesday for talks with Russian President Vladimir Putin. After postponing his previous trip to Moscow, which was scheduled for last week, the Israeli leader reiterated the importance of maintaining close cooperation with Russia on regional challenges that threaten Israel's national security interests.
במוסקבה עם נשיא רוסיה ולדימיר פוטין, שוחחנו בטלפון שיחה קדומנית לקראת המפגש הזה, וכמובן הנושא של איראן יהיה בראש סדר הדיונים שלנו, על כך הסכמנו. אני אדון עמו על ההתפתחויות באזור ובתוקפנות האיראנית, נדון גם בחיזוק מנגנון התיאום הביטחוני בין צה"ל וצבא רוסיה, וזה כדי לשמור על על היציבות ולמנוע חיכוכים מיותרים באזור. השיחות הללו חשובות לביטחון, חשובות לצבא ההגנה לישראל, חשובות מאוד למדינת ישראל.
Now to Iran, the Islamic Republic's foreign minister, Mohammad Javad Zarif, claimed that efforts by the United States to garner global consensus against the Ayatollah regime has utterly failed. In an address to the University of Tehran on Iran's foreign policy, Zarif asserted that Washington's efforts to unite the world on the matter of abandoning the Iranian nuclear agreement indicates that the age of unilateralism and Western hegemony is fading, while global multilateralism has emerged instead. Furthermore, Minister Zarif disputed the sincerity of Washington and Jerusalem about Tehran's nuclear aspirations, claiming that their efforts aim at isolating Iran rather than thwarting its nuclear and military ambitions. Now, in other news, the Iranian Navy announced that it successfully test-fired a cruise missile during its annual naval exercise dubbed Vilayat 97. According to the official IRNA news agency, on the third day of the exercises, a Gadil-class Iranian Navy submarine successfully launched a cruise missile. The test launch was reportedly made in the Strait of Hormuz, an important sea artery where a third of the world's seaborne oil cargo passes through daily. A U.S. Navy official told TV7 that the Iranian maritime drill is monitored closely because of repeated threats by the IRGC, the Iranian Revolutionary Guard Corps, to block the strategic strait in response to the tough international sanctions that were imposed by the Trump administration on Iran's oil exports. The U.S. official, who spoke on condition of anonymity, stressed that while Iran continues to undermine regional stability, the United States Navy, together with its international partners, will continue to protect the commercial maritime routes and will not hesitate to act in the face of Iranian aggression. Now to a related matter, the Islamic Republic's Revolutionary Guard Corps accused enemies of Iran of trying to sabotage the country's missiles, yet claimed that those attempts were successfully thwarted. According to the commander of the IRGC's Aerospace Division, Amir Ali Hajizadeh, the referred to enemies, which he did not mention, tried as best as they could to sabotage a small part which the Islamic Republic imports so that its missiles would not reach their targets and explode mid-air. While the senior IRGC official claimed that all of the efforts were thwarted, a report that was published by the New York Times earlier this month revealed that a secret U.S. program to sabotage Iran's missiles and rockets had been in existence for years and was being accelerated by the Trump administration. The report elaborated on the efforts, which began under U.S. President George W. Bush, in which faulty parts were inserted into Iran's missile supply chains in an effort to undermine launches and aerospace development. While Iran claims to successfully thwart these efforts, the Islamic Republic's failure rate in its rocket and missile programs is a staggering 67% compared to the global orbital launch failure average of 5%. Now to Israel's eastern neighbor Egypt, where a first historic summit between the European Union and the League of Arab States concluded this evening, with economic cooperation and conflict resolution topping the conference's agenda. At the opening remarks of the summit, which was held in the Red Sea resort of Sharm el-Sheikh, the president of the European Council, Donald Tusk, stressed the importance of working together to confront what he referred to as common challenges.
In a time of growing tension and unpredictability, we need to work together, taking into account our shared interests and common challenges to create the right conditions for long-term stability, which is the only way to guarantee our citizens the peace and prosperity they deserve.
Despite the European Council's president's admission to existing differences between Europe and the Arab world, he urged all sides to work together on shared interests that will allow them to remove global powers from the equation of regional meddling.
I am aware that there are differences between us. We are not here to pretend that we agree on everything, but we face common challenges and have shared interests. Today, we are here to strengthen our cooperation for the benefit of our peoples. We need to do this together and not leave it to global powers far from our region.
While President Tusk refrained from elaborating on the focus of his statement, the European Union's foreign policy chief voiced her aspiration that the summit would primarily focus on economic cooperation and conflict resolution.
So I hope that the summit manages to focus on our partnership when it comes to economic relations, when it comes to our common work, for instance, on Palestine and peace between Israel and Palestine and between Israel and the Arab world, revitalizing the two-state solution, but also a common approach, I hope, on the conflict in Syria, on the conflict in Yemen, to try and have a full implementation of the Stockholm agreements, and a common work on Libya.
At the end of the summit, Egypt's President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi called for resolving the decades-old Israeli-Palestinian conflict among more recent wars in Syria, Yemen, and Libya. Thank you for watching us. Keep praying for the peace of Israel and the peace of Jerusalem. Jonathan Hassan, have a erev tov and shavua tov. We will see you again tomorrow at the same time.